Drones started off as toys, then they became useful tools in the hands of skilled operators, and now they're becoming basic infrastructure themselves, persistently network connected, docked, and operating remotely and autonomously in the background to do useful work for us. Last year, we announced Dock for X10. And since we started installing beta docks in February of this year, our customers have done over 13,000 flights on these systems across the US and Japan. Many of these dock drones are averaging over 10 flights a day. They represent a tiny percentage of our overall fleet, but already a meaningful fraction of the flight volume, which is a really powerful indicator for what dock can do. It takes all the friction out of flying a drone, which means they can be used in more places by more people. And we're now transitioning from beta deployments to full-scale general availability of the hardware and software. Our factory is cranking. Soon, rooftops everywhere are going to look like this. Now, our teams have been sprinting on connectivity, attachments, autonomous flight, integrations, cloud operation, and more, all the ingredients to make this possible. Along with general availability of the dock, today we're announcing a second generation of X10. It has improved connectivity, a bunch of tweaks to improve performance and reliability, a new color scheme, and it's fully backwards compatible with the rest of the ecosystem. And all of this is aimed at making X10 the most capable, reliable, scalable enterprise drone on the planet. What matters most is the impact these products are having for the core industries that our civilization runs on. Public safety agencies are using dock-based DFR to get on scene in seconds and capture stolen vehicle suspects without a dangerous pursuit, identify critically injured people and direct EMS for fast response, apprehend battery suspects, get valuable intel on fires, and help those in need. Critical infrastructure operators have also been using docks for asset inspection. Pre-planned missions using our remote ops software autonomously fly precise routes, capturing data to monitor asset health and performance. And when there's an incident, an inspection flight can be launched within seconds without waiting for a crew to arrive on scene. We get to hear dozens of these stories a day, and I asked some of our early dock customers to share them with you.
Dock itself is fantastic.
It has exceeded our expectations.
We've felt confident in the system.
We've been trying to do DFR for about 3 years. I can tell you that this thing has been super successful in our town.
Your team has been responsive like this.
We've tried several other docks. We tried the DJI Dock 1. Looked into Dock 2, worked with other companies like Paladin, Aerodome.
We've flown it in rain, snow, and we've also flown it in a combination of high winds and rain, and the drone did a very good job.
This integration with the artificial intelligence for our research and development has truly transformed this system. We must have gotten intruder.
We're currently flying right now out of our hangar at our helicopter operations. It's all tied into our real-time operations crime center.
We flew it at night as well. A lot of break-ins happened during those night periods, so being able to fly it at night may prevent those or even catch people in the act.
We've been able to use it to catch bad guys. We've used it to do fires. We've used it out of the dock to map wrecks.
Our scheduled missions have been through the day, through the night. We're getting over 13,000 feet a linear distance away from the dock.
We had an incident last week. He was armed. We were able to deploy our dock from our police central and get eyes on him before any of our officers arrive, potentially life-saving for not only our citizens, but for him even.
The drone as a first responder is more than just a force multiplier, an autonomous force multiplier.
Reliability is the single most important feature, and building a dock drone system is similar in technical complexity to building a rocket ship or a self-driving car. There are two keys to achieving high reliability on these systems: controlling the entire technology stack, from the dock, to the drone, to the manufacturing processes, to the autonomy software and the cloud software that orchestrates it all, and relentless improvement based on real-world experience and learnings. The X10 is our fifth generation drone, and Dock for X10 is our third generation dock. Our customers have done over 2.3 million flights to date, and that number is rising rapidly. We're continually iterating on every aspect of the hardware and software. And in fact, X10 today is 3 times as reliable as when we first shipped it 18 months ago. This kind of rapid progress is only possible because we control the whole stack. Whether it's a hardware issue with the drone or the dock, a software issue, or a manufacturing defect, it's all our responsibility, but it's also all under our control. When something goes wrong, we have a team dedicated to diagnosing and fixing these issues, often in less than 24 hours. As one example of rapid iteration, since we started our dock beta in February, we've done 6 cloud software releases and 5 vehicle firmware updates. We've also been building up our manufacturing line and are now quickly scaling production. If you've ordered a dock for deployment this year, you should expect to receive it soon. Connectivity is one of the key pillars of technology for drones. Historically, drones have relied on point-to-point radios, which in theory can have very long ranges, but in practical usage, interference always shrinks that range dramatically, and obstacles can get in the way. In a manually flown drone world, this is fine, because you're not going to fly beyond visual line of sight anyways, but this is never going to enable the kind of ubiquitous usage we want for drones as infrastructure. These point-to-point radios are why early DFR programs required flying at extremely high altitudes. It was your only hope of maintaining line of sight and maintaining connectivity. Over the last couple of years, we've been building up a fundamentally different connectivity architecture based on fusing multiple links. We have a great point-to-point link in ConnectSL, but we've also built 5G into X10 to take advantage of the ubiquitous cell networks that all of our phones use all the time. The key to getting great connectivity performance is not just adding a cellular modem, it's fusing the links together at the operating system level. With Connect Fusion, you get the best possible performance and robustness by getting the best out of both links at every moment of the flight. If you have a cellular-enabled X10, you're already benefiting from our partnership with T-Mobile. With our second generation X10, we're adding the ability for customers to bring their own plan. AT&T, FirstNet, T-Mobile, and T-Mobile Priority Service are all supported. Support for Verizon is coming soon, and in Japan, we support KDDI and NTT. Customers today are regularly flying multi-mile missions in extremely congested, challenging environments, but we're not done innovating on Connect Fusion. Today, we're announcing Connect Fusion Plus, which gives you the option to add a second onboard cellular modem operating on a second cellular network. This gives you up to 3 active data pipes, 2 on cellular plus Connect SL, and Connect Fusion Plus will optimally use all 3 of these pipes simultaneously to get you the best bandwidth and the best robustness. From a hardware standpoint, this is enabled with our Fusion Plus attachment, which works with any generation of X10 and will be available later this year. In addition to working on the major technology pillars, we're also always grinding away at the little stuff based on customer feedback to make every flight experience a little bit safer, a little bit more enjoyable, and a little bit more impactful. I'll give you a few examples. We're bringing airspace awareness via ADS-B, which we've always had on the web, to the enterprise controller, so you can see it on every flight. We've developed frame lock, where the drone visually locks on to the foreground material to keep it perfectly steady in frame, even if the drone itself is being blown around by the wind. We've made it easy to create and name custom folders on the drone live while you're flying, so that by the time you land, your imagery is already perfectly organized. We've added map capture options to remote flight deck that make it super easy to tune optimal capture for solar farms. And we've added some tools that make it easy to frame the precise image that you want, with center point, grid lines, and diagonal lines. I want to give everyone a battery update. The rationing plan that we were forced to adopt at the end of last year of only shipping 1 battery for each new drone we deliver has been extremely painful for our customers. This is now coming to an end. We're already fulfilling against our backlog. I really appreciate everybody's patience and support during this process. The new battery comes in 2 flavors. We've got the standard version, and we've got the dock version, which has the cooling fins and the dock charging port. Now, it's quite likely that these new batteries will actually have increased performance over our old systems that will unlock over time with software updates. One of the things that makes X10 such a powerful platform is its modularity and extensibility. Earlier this year, we announced our interface control document, or ICD, for X10D. We're now opening up modularity for the entire X10 family. You can request the ICD on our website or ask your Skydio rep. So if you have an idea for a payload that we don't offer, you can build it yourself. We're also charging ahead, building more and more attachments ourselves for X10 using these same interfaces. Anytime an aviation asset goes into the air, whether it's a commercial jetliner, a private plane, a helicopter, or a drone, there is some level of risk. And as usage scales up, so does the risk exposure. Whether it's someone actually shooting at the drone,
shot at their drone. You could see the moment,
or a bird strike, both of which happen more than you might think, or a rare technical failure, which we're working to make even more rare, there are things that can cause the drone to fall out of the sky that are out of your control. Parachute is the ultimate fallback for peace of mind, final layer of safety protection, and it enables compliant Part 107 operations over people. Now, you might remember that we had previously announced we were developing a parachute in partnership with a third party. The deeper we got into it, the more that we realized that the program we were working on was not going to deliver the level of safety and performance that we felt like we needed to deliver. So we reset, pulled the program in-house, and developed it ourselves. Many legacy drone parachute systems use a spring to deploy the parachute. These springs are very heavy, and they're also relatively slow, which means that you need to fly at high altitudes in order to be sure the parachute's going to open before the drone gets to the ground. In partnership with Axon, we've come up with a fundamentally better deployment methodology. We actually use the cartridge from a Taser 7 to deliver the energy to pop the chute. This is super light, it's super reliable, and it's 5 times faster than using a spring. This means that the minimum altitude for safe deployment in every case is 100 feet, and in many cases, it's just over 50 feet. We've tested this thing a lot. Parachute is available in early access now, with general availability coming later this year. I'm also super excited about our dropper attachment, which was designed to help our public safety customers get life preservers to people struggling in the water. Dropper is already in deployment with NYPD to help them keep the beaches of New York City safer.
Boom. See, as soon as it makes contact, it opens up into a flotation device.
And we're industrializing it now to scale up access to all of our customers. We've gone up the stack from the dock to the drone to the attachments. But one of the beautiful things about dock is that most of the people who use and benefit from the drone never have to physically touch hardware. DFR Command is designed to be the ultimate software to run DFR operations end-to-end from the cloud. And since this is how most people will experience DFR, we're continuing to crank on features to make it more capable, powerful, and useful. The new dispatch view gives instant insight into everything an operator needs to manage their fleet and respond to incidents. You select the incident to respond to, and DFR Command now recommends the best drone based on distance, battery level, and other metrics. And we've now made it even easier to share ready links. You can now create distribution lists of users and external contacts and share ready links with them automatically or on demand via email or text. You can also group a set of vehicles together within a ready link so the viewers can monitor multiple streams of an incident or operation. We've added more health monitoring features for docks and drones alike to help with proactive maintenance. And we continue to build out functionality in the transparency dashboard to help build community trust in DFR operations. Agencies across the country have been integrating DFR Command with their CAD systems. So when a call for service comes in, the operator can launch a drone and be en route in 20 seconds or less. Our free and open Markers API can support any CAD system. We've got lots of these active today and more coming soon. Fundamental to DFR is getting there fast. However, in many environments, this is not straightforward. Hills, buildings, airspace regulations, policies can greatly complicate the airspace. These can be high cognitive load moments while en route trying to assess the situation. That's why we created Pathfinder. Pathfinder uses AI to find the optimal path and fully automates the flight. It takes into account terrain data, building locations, airspace regulations, local agency policies, and geofences. This eliminates cognitive load for the operator, enabling them to focus on the things most important to the mission, such as looking for suspects and communicating with officers on the ground. Pathfinder is shipping to all of our dock-based DFR customers now, and will expand from there. Autonomous drones really are becoming basic infrastructure. Remote operations are transforming asset inspections, site security, and mapping for our civilization's core industries. And DFR will be live in hundreds of cities across the US by the end of this year. I think this is the most exciting time to be alive in human history as AI and autonomy come to life in the physical world.
We're launching a drone from Fire Station 7 to assist with Spring Lake's pursuit.
We're headed towards an awesome future of autonomous flying robots doing useful work on our behalf.
Just did the fly now option.